You don't have to be so Catholic. Okay. Well done. Well done. And now you're stuck. Bobby Vogel's going to join you. Welcome to the 34th Annual Peter and Viola Dolle Lecture on Church Art and Architecture. Tonight's presenters are Father Godfrey Mullen of the Order of St. Benedict and Mr. Michael Eagan of Entheos Architects. Father Godfrey Mullen is a Benedictine monk of St. Minor at Arch Abbey. He entered the monastery in 1988 and was ordained a priest in 1994. And since then, he has served as a parish priest, as the monastery choir master, as a seminary administrator in many, many departments, earned a doctorate in liturgy from the Catholic University of America in 2003, and spent 4 years as vice rector of this seminary. He is an assistant professor of liturgical and sacramental theology on leave. Beginning in 2012, he has been engaged in parish ministry in the Diocese of Evansville and has been the rector of St. Benedict Cathedral since 2013. In that position, he led the cathedral through a capital campaign and renovation, and more recently has initiated stewardship as a way of life in the parish. He gives retreats and parish missions and serves as a spiritual director. With him is Mr. Michael Eagan. Mr. Eagan was raised right across the street from Our Lady of Grace Monastery, Benedictine Women's Community in Indianapolis. He attended Holy Name Catholic Parish and the grade school and Roncalli High School, so he knows the Archdiocese of Indianapolis very well. He graduated from Ball State University College of Architecture and Planning in 1982 with a Bachelor of Architecture and a Bachelor of Science in Environmental Design. Mr. Eagan is a registered architect in the state of Indiana, a member of the American Institute of Architects, and a member of the Interfaith Forum on Religion, Art, and Architecture. He co-founded Entheos Architects in 1999. It's a small architectural firm, but it focuses on faith-based institutional work, such as worship facilities, parochial schools, and higher education, mostly for Catholic institutions in Indiana, Ohio, and Kentucky. With his wife, Linda, a Catholic school teacher. He has two adult children, and he is active in his parish and committed to Catholic faith and education. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Father Godfrey and Mr. Eagan.
So let's begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Raise up in your church, O Lord, that spirit with which you animated our Holy Father, St. Benedict, that filled with that same spirit, we may learn to love what he loved and to practice what he taught through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
St. Cyprian and Cornelius.
Pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It's a pleasure to be here. As I was preparing for this lecture, which Father Harry asked me to do more than 2 years ago, and then COVID, of course, like with so many things, got in the way of that. I remembered sitting through this lecture 14 times as a member of the faculty, and I thought to myself, will they hear anything? And then I thought, it'll probably be better if we just show pictures. So a lot of what we're going to do tonight is show pictures. And if you are looking for the theology of church renovation, I encourage you to take some kind of an elective sometime while you're in the seminary or somewhere else. So this is the facade of our cathedral in Evansville. It sits right on Lincoln Avenue, a busy thoroughfare in Evansville. And it's a parish of 1,150 families and 300 children in the school and about 3,000 people who call this place their spiritual home. When Bishop Joseph Siegel was installed as Bishop of Evansville on December 15th, 2017, this is what the place looked like. As people love to say, it's so green and yellow. And as I love to tell the story, Father Donald oversaw the painting of the church in 1958, and it was built in 1927 and 1928. And I said to Father Donald in the 1990s, Donald, what were you thinking when you did St. Ben's? And he snorted very loudly and he said, Godfrey, not every piece can be a masterpiece. Which proved to me, of course, that he knew it wasn't great either. So, it certainly has a beautiful structure, and it certainly had a lot of potential, but it also had been let go for a long, long time. Tonight, our plan really is to address the practical and theological work of renovating a church, and in particular, renovating a cathedral. I promise you that renovating a cathedral is more complicated than renovating a parish church because, well, the bishop is more present. And it's more complicated still when halfway through the planning of the renovation you change bishops. And so I don't recommend that to any of you if you're ever a cathedral rector. Just shut it down and put your head down and move on. But in fact, Bishop Siegel and Archbishop Thompson were very easy to deal with. And I think it's fair to say that they were instrumental in us moving forward. Our plan for the renovation was really not to redo the church, and it was also not to restore the church. When we started the campaign, those campaign people love to use language that isn't necessarily helpful. And so they always said, we want to restore it to its majestic beauty. For the first 30 years that it existed, there was absolutely no paint on the walls. And there was a giant crack in the arch above the baldacchino that made everyone nervous. And so restoring it was not exactly what we wanted to do. What we wanted to do was build on the strengths of this building that was built in 27 and 28, and attending to what we needed for today. As I said, this is a picture of the installation of Bishop Siegel. You can see that there are some strange aspects to the architecture and really the design of the church. You can see dated teal and orange paint, what were fondly known by the parishioners as the witch hat chandeliers, decoration that was somewhat lacking, simple bishop's chair. You may not even be able to tell where the bishop's chair is, but it's right there. Okay? All due respect to the holy people of Jasper who built that, it's a simple bishop's chair. You can see the incongruency of dated teal and orange paint and these kind of New Age banners that were hung up for the installation. What you can't see in this picture is the original electrical work that was installed in the 1920s. You can't see the hallucinogenic ceiling design, and you can't see the repeated roof leaks that caused ceiling tiles that were a foot square sopping wet to fall from the ceiling and land on the pews right after Mass one Sunday. You can't see the weary carpet in the sanctuary, which was rose-colored when it was put in and became just dirty over time. And after it was clean, it stayed dirty. You can't see the incredibly uncomfortable pews that were too close and built by German people who decided that no one should be comfortable in church. And you certainly may not even be able to find the tabernacle. It's almost as inconsequential as the bishop's chair. When I arrived in 2013, the choir sat in front of the tabernacle. It was lovely. But what we did have, and we knew we had, was a strong Lombard Romanesque feature, a baldacchino that was really the icon of our parish. Windows by F.X. Zettler, the same company that built the window, that produced the windows for the Abbey Church. The transparency of pillars from the pews. It was the largest kind of freestanding roof at the time when it was built in the state of Indiana, so that the pillars were on the outside of the pews and not in the middle of them. You can see the grand nature of the clerestory and the spectacular view from the choir loft. These were the things that we wanted to build on. At the very beginning of the document Built of Living Stones, the document of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops on the Renovation of Churches, they say one of the most significant and formative experiences in the life of a parish community is the process of building or renovating a church. And I can tell you that that is absolutely true. It is significant and it is formative. We needed to make necessary improvements for the safety of our parishioners, to the structure that we loved so much, and God knows we needed some beauty in that church. And so we had plenty of strong opinions from the parishioners who came up to me and said, "We've been going to Mass here for 55 years, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with this church," to people who understood that there was plenty that needed to happen. The old document on preaching from the National Conference of Catholic Bishops in 1982 said, "We believe that it is appropriate, indeed essential, to begin this treatment of the Sunday homily with the assembly rather than with the preacher or the homily." And I can say that that simple principle of attending to the needs of the assembly was really what kept us focused throughout all of our work. Consider the assembly. At that time, 1,200 families on the books. Father Gregory Chamberlain, a monk of St. Meinrad, had been pastor of St. Benedict's for 22 years, the last two with cancer. For 2 years, every Sunday, there were substitute priests. The parish had been in debt for most of its 100 years. And in the years 2013, 14, and 15, it was my privilege to announce to them that there had been a $410,000 misappropriation from funds that had been given for the replacement of the church roof. There had been $135,000 worth of script cards that had been stolen, and $167,000 stolen from our cafeteria. There was debt for property that was a 7-year loan that had been now paid for 8 years, and only $2,000 out of $175,000 of the principal had been paid. The church roof needed to be replaced, and the tuck point in the bricks on the cathedral was also long past due, and that work would be in the neighborhood of $1.8 million. News of becoming the cathedral in 1999 was not warmly received by the people of St. Benedict Parish. They thought that the diocese would take advantage of the parish and use our facilities without paying, and they were right. The pastor that they loved had died, and many things seemed bleak. And then Archbishop Thompson announced that the diocese would initiate a diocesan capital campaign, and that created more consternation, because we wanted to raise more than the diocese set as our goal. We had to pay for the campaign ourselves, in addition to paying the assessment for the campaign for the diocese that was given to us. And so it was a daunting task to bring up the question of renovation. Through a stroke of genius of someone else, I established a pastoral council in 2014 that spent 3 years focused on hospitality. And it was that move that I think prepared us for the work of renovation. Our work was about more than beautifying or even restoring. It was about welcome. We welcomed Entheos Architects, and in particular Michael Eagan, and that truly made all the difference.
Thank you for this opportunity to speak to the seminarians, staff, visitors. It's really an honor to be able to speak to you. As a Saran, I want you to know that you seminarians have our full support and prayer, daily prayers. We think the world of you guys, so hang in there. We're praying for you. What we hope to do is show you the hows and whys of how we transform parish church into a cathedral. You know, as Father Godfrey mentioned, there are plenty of challenges with the conditions of the cathedral. You know, the carpet in the sanctuary, I didn't know it was red. It looks like it's kind of gray right there in the lower left-hand corner there. It's kind of a, you know, marble and carpet. You know, it's kind of strange. He mentioned the lighting, and then there's a good view of the ceiling tiles and the, what I kind of call graphics on the ceiling. You know, it's easy to identify the shortcomings, isn't it? You know? I think the challenge is, and a much more worthwhile endeavor, is to find, enhance, and celebrate the treasures that are there. This is the smallest window in the cathedral, the tiniest window in the cathedral. But look at the geometry, very simple geometry, the symbolism. You can find the Benedictine crosses in there. The harmony and the colors. I mean, they're Crayola colors. You know, there's about 10 of them there, 8 of them there, and they all work. You know, very simple. So I think that was part of our job, was to figure out what was worthwhile to bring back and enhance and to celebrate. We found wonderful things where the existing holy water fonts, they were trash. They tarnished to a point where you thought these couldn't be any good. And we were able to restore them to really their original condition. When we renovate or design new churches, we're using the document that Father Godfrey mentioned, the Built of Living Stones. That's our guidelines. What I want to use is chapter 2, which focuses on the church building and sacred rites celebrated there. And the one comment that to me speaks a world of information is, the celebration of the Eucharist is the center of the entire Christian life. If we kind of keep that in the forefront of our thoughts as we move through all of the different elements, it's a really great guidepost for us to follow. As we focus on the building, the document speaks of the eminence and transcendence of God. The churches are a sign of the pilgrim church on earth. And how does the building convey the image of the gathered assembly? You know, just look at this one slide here, and it's It's a horizontal slide, but look at all the lines in there. The massing of the building points upward. The arches, the windows, all point to God. The roof lines, even though you can't quite see all of them. The bell tower, everything is going up. The document talks about the area surrounding the church, how the outside of the church can proclaim the gospel to the community. And it talks about bell towers and things like that. We didn't do much work on the site, so I want to show you some other things that might convey those concepts. Where we took, this is the corner of a church in downtown Indianapolis, St. Mary's, a Gothic church, and this is essentially the entrance to the church. It's an accessible ramp that sort of celebrates the tower and wraps around it and finds its way to the doors of the church. And if you look at how that's really executed in plan or in elevation here, to me, it speaks to all are welcome. The church was built by German immigrants, designed and constructed by German immigrants. An Anglo community worshipped in there for the last half of the 21st century. The parish now embraces a growing Hispanic community. So the sign, as you can see, says Iglesia de Santa Maria, St. Mary Catholic Church. Someday it'll have the German descendants listed on there. You know, it's a graceful ramp. It's not a wood deck construction that you see. It's permanent. It's stone. And it serves all those that need that, the elderly, those with physical limitations, and celebrates existing architecture. We talk about how towers can identify the entrance to a church. How a horizontal church can be enhanced. This is one that has low roof lines, but and very little glass, but the addition to the front has very unique doors that celebrate as you enter the church. It's a light-filled gathering space that then leads you into the church. Many of you are probably familiar with Francis and Claire, where the towers are over the Blessed Sacrament Chapel. St. Benedict in Columbus is a nautilus shell and plan, but then it climbs to a tower three-dimensionally over the located over the tabernacle. And then sometimes we as architects get a little too excited. And this isn't our work, but to me this speaks, it looks like a tower that happens to have a building located behind it. Train station, convenience store, I'm not sure which, but. And then this is St. Mary of the Knobs. I don't have a good picture of it here, but it has two spires, one above the sanctuary and one above the baptismal font. So I guess part of my effort here is to inspire some of the seminarians as they go out in the world and think about the many things that they are able to affect in this process. You know, the gathering space is talked about and how it's a transitional space from everyday life to sacred space and how it can facilitate processions and baptisms and funeral rites, and there's some other practical considerations. This is at the cathedral, and you know, we weren't able to gather natural light in that space. An internal space. We extended the balcony over it to create the space. Really, the gathering space was essentially about 8 feet between the two doors of the church, okay? So it was really a vestibule. And if you stood there and shook someone's hand and talked to them, you were in the way. So that didn't seem to be very welcoming. But this transitional space serves to as a transition from secular to sacred. It's a space that welcomes, it accommodates conversation, It maintains the sacred space of the nave. And finally, it invites one to enter and experience Mass or other sacraments or private prayer. With, if you see the glass and how it is very open to the sacred space, yet all the sound is contained within the gathering space. The gates to the balcony are a simple symbol to, you know, we could have put a sign up that said keep out, but instead we reused some gates from the jail statue, the statue jail, and I'll show you a picture of that later, but another element of finding the treasures and reusing them somewhere else. One of the things that people like to use the gathering space for, or one of the things parishioners like to refer to the gathering space as, is the cry room. And I always try to steer folks away from that concept. Seems to me like a lot of juvenile activity is born in a cry room. And perhaps maybe we just retreat to the gathering space to gather our child, let them contain the crying and bring him back into Mass. The baptistry, there's many comments about baptism and the baptistry and what it ought to symbolize. We played with a lot of ideas at the cathedral. This is kind of a different example. I share this to illustrate part of the church history that I'm guessing that your professors have expressed. It was the great holy water shortage of the 1960s. Some of you might be familiar with it. You know, this font was made out of marble, and the basin wasn't small enough, so they stuck another glass liner in there to make. So we didn't use any of that precious water that we had a shortage of. You know, I think it's important to share, to express the full importance of all the sacraments, and baptism is one of those. You know, there's ways to do that. This particular font shows flowing water. It uses an existing font. It allows for both adult and infant baptisms. That happens to be located in the front of the sanctuary. This font happens to be located just beyond the gathering space at the edge of the nave, still part of the liturgical space. This is the font at St. Mary's and Knobs, on axes to the main, to the altar. We went through a lot of studies, and I'll share with you in a moment what we came up with there. You know, the existing font had some challenges. You can see that it was needed to be restored. It kind of had some curious things with, if you look down at the bottom here, there's a valve and plumbing exposed. There's kind of an extra base on it that kept it from tipping over, I suspect. So we took it apart, and we hid the plumbing, and we drilled the columns, and we hid the plumbing in the central column, and we cleaned it up, and ended up with a pretty simple, clean font, and located in the sanctuary. In a moment, I'll share how that relates to other pieces. In the background there, you can see the Marian shrine that we did not have one at the time, or we had one, but it was different. Okay, so the overall plan, if you look at these short vestibules here, that was the gathering space, essentially. And what we created was, we used that for airlocks, we created restrooms that were accessible to those with challenges. We created stairwells that took up a lot of space, but we have two stairwells to the balcony, because essentially they had spiral stairs and those don't meet code. So the balcony stopped right here, and we extended extended that out to the next Tyler Square and created a gathering space in there, so long gathering space. We used ceramic tile on the floor and extended that ceramic tile up the center aisle and onto the sanctuary platform. We also picked up the cross aisle here in tile. The area under the pews, we refinished the old wood floor and it turned out beautiful. The other aisles were all cork that had been replaced or had been restored previously, and we reused all of that. We created accessible ramps to the lower level of the sanctuary platform. In a future project, there'll be a connection here or an addition here that allows access to the upper level. And basically, maybe my message here is, you get in a historic building, you have all of these existing conditions, and you do what you think is reasonable to meet the needs of the time. So we don't have full access to the sanctuary platform, but we will at some point in time. You'll see that we moved the AMBO directly in front of the Shrine of St. Joseph. We kept the font on a little bit lower level, and that's a bit of the hierarchy we're talking about. The altar stayed where it is. We placed the tabernacle immediately behind the altar. And the bishop's chair, the Catholic was here. The presider and deacon are over here. The presbytery is behind the altar, and so you can see there's a backdrop there that allows visibility to the sanctuary platform. Now, some of the things we studied here, this is something preliminary, but just to show you some of the challenges here. We played with the font in a different location. Honestly, a thought I had, I have to say this, Godfrey, but I always thought that at the center of this space, this is one of the churches that would really facilitate where a font at the center of the space would work nicely. The architecture suggests it. Where everyone approaches the building, they all come in from three different sides pretty equally. You know, it's not everybody coming in from the center. But there's always, you know, there was good reason to put that in the front of the church. You know, there's challenges people want. They want to see, you know, and that would be a challenge, placing it in the center of the church. At one time, we were studying the music ministry in the apse of the church because that's how they used it, and you'll see why we chose not to do that after a while. The blue seats represent the presbytery, and as you know, we placed them in the apse. So these were some early studies that showed really focusing on the front of the church and how music ministry might work behind the baldacchino and how the presbytery could be on either side, the font could be probably a little bit more visible. And, you know, it just became too cluttered up there. You can see here where the balcony really stopped at one point right here, and we extended the wall out to the next pilaster. You can see big stairwells back there. These are future pipes. Well, some of them were existing pipes for the pipe organ that were removed. And at some point in the near future, the organ will be restored and expanded. And then this is some early images of the gathering space. You know, the congregational area, you know, making sure that it's not a space for an audience, that it's one one community, a single body, and how do we facilitate that? The document talks about the sanctuary area and how is it distinctive in its design? How are the materials, are they noble and dignified? Are we identifying the principal elements of altar, ambo, chair? And so this was an almost completed photo of the space, and you can see how there's a real balance to the space now. With there are two shrines on either side that did not exist in the past. The altar is center under the baldacchino. There you can see the amble on one side, the font on the other side. There's the cathedral, and there's the presider's chair. Plenty of space to move around in there, and a use of dignified materials up there that, signify the sanctuary. So this is another space, and, I just wanted to share this with you just to see how a contemporary space might result in address similar concepts and of a balanced space, of a hierarchical space, substitute the reredos for the baldacchino, and how there's a sacred backdrop to all of everything that's going on there. But a particular note, the windows in here are for our Brother Martin of the community. I don't know if he's here tonight. Is Brother Martin here? No, okay. They're beautiful. The altar, you know, the idea that the altar is Christ, and, the materials that, the altar is made of, are those noble, and, are they strong? Is the altar the focus of the space, and is it visible from all parts of the church? So you know, this is the result of that, and, really the altar, this is what the altar looked like when we started, and the two major things we did to it was there was the Lamb of God on the back of the altar, and we really couldn't cut the stone up to bring it to the front. So we created a replica of it and placed it on the front. We did this with, this is really done, this is a Photoshop image down here, and it helped the bishop understand what we were trying to do. The second thing we did is we simply capped, put a new cap on the altar, a new mensa on the altar, and took the relic that was from the top, in the top of the altar, and placed it right in front of and in the floor of the sanctuary. The ambo, you know, they talk about being a place for expressing the word of God in an noble fashion, and the ambo that we started with was pretty unknowable. That'd be the right terminology. You know, it was all metal, bent metal, and pretty minimalist kind of piece. And we actually ended up using that as a canter stand and built some things into it, a speaker and whatnot. The documents also talk about its relationship to the altar, and you can see this is a metal ambo, and the altar is marble. So what we came up with was a piece that picks up on some of the detailing of the existing altar, and creates a nice place to proclaim the word, easy access to it, a very prominent location. It looks tall, it wants to feel vertical and prominent in space. There are a couple of things there. The little speaker here, we still weren't done with things, so the speaker ends up inside of the cap of the ambo, and that's just something for the presider to hear what's being said. And then, just kind of a fun fact here, this is a good example of when someone doesn't drill a hole in the marble in the place that they were supposed to. So you can see there's two holes for microphones, and look closely someday, you'll see where the one got patched. Presider's chair and cathedral, thinking about the placement of that, that it doesn't feel remote or grandiose. And this is what we started with. Pretty throne-like and removed. The surroundings were pretty scarce around it, and so the next thing we found out was that there was an existing piece that was at the chancery in Evansville that, could we work on this? And it was kind of torn apart. You can see different pieces. This is the dome, the cross is on top, and a all of the fabric or all the leather was worn out, could we reconfigure this? And so we took that piece and had it essentially redone and reassembled and created a cathedral where the bishop can stand here, sit here, and he can see the ambo, he can see everything that's going on, and have a presence in the cathedral. We had an existing sedilia, which I don't know what they were really ever used for, but it's, it might have been the initial futon or something, I don't know. So we, you know, it kind of has three different expressions there. So we took that and we cut it up and we created a presider's chair and a deacon's chair and reupholstered it and had it work with the cathedral, and it's placed on the opposite side of the sanctuary platform. You know, the reservation of the Eucharist and how well is that done, and are we creating a sacred place for the tabernacle? And you can see the original arrangement on the left. There was this seven-legged pedestal for the tabernacle, and I think it may have been some of the pieces of the old high altar, but the way they were reused was curious. What we did was we picked up on the existing altar right in front of it, similar pieces, same marble. We had was this the original tabernacle? Okay. So they had another tabernacle there. It did not have a top to it. They had lost the top. We created something that was reflective of what Father Godfrey mentioned of the baldacchino. And then we created a backdrop behind it that provided some separation from the presbytery behind there, but also allowed for visibility. So these are some of this is like the tracery in the windows of the cathedral, the tracery of the exterior windows of the cathedral, or the tracery in the back by the gathering space. I hope there are no pastoral musicians here. The place for pastoral musicians. So I had to show this. I felt so sorry for this organist. I mean, that person must have been just horrible, right? Put him in this little cattle thing, you know? I had something that couldn't really jump over, I guess. I don't know. So, place for pastoral. You know, we all know that pastoral musicians are very messy. You can kind of, but it's just because all the stuff they have, right? You know, and they're very creative too, like architects. So, they had two locations at the cathedral. They had one up in front, in the apse of the church, that was really more for parish choir. And then when they had diocesan events, they put folks upstairs in the loft. And it was very crowded and difficult to get to and dark, and probably the world's highest balcony. I mean, it's way up there. So after studying several things, what you saw, what it meant to put the choir back in front, we decided the best thing to do is to put both choirs up in the choir loft. And so probably looks a little empty in this photo, but eventually there'll be pipes on either side of the windows there, and if you go up there, you can see that the space is organized. You know, there's ample space. There's treatment in here for sound and acoustics with elements that disperse sound up there, so the choir can hear a little bit of what they're doing. There's space for the future pipes. When we looked at lighting, you know, part of what we did here was, Father Godfrey mentioned that you couldn't really appreciate the ceiling which was a good thing, because there wasn't any light on it. And so you can see here where we used a lot of up lighting to light that ceiling. In fact, it was a long time before I could focus on what was there before. And we made the ceiling much more of a, it was a beautiful ceiling, and basically we used it as an acoustical element, and we painted it, and we lit it, and we put some messages up there, and I'll come to those in a moment. We also reinterpreted the existing light fixtures, made them very simple. You can sort of see the cross in there, and the circular elements, and repetitive crosses. So this is the Marian Shrine. This was Mary in her guard shack, right? On the left. And so we, this is Joseph, obviously, but both sides are very similar. Again, they pick up on the tracery of the windows. We couldn't afford gold leaf behind there. We found a gold ceramic tile that reflected light. It was very reflective, maybe the best way to say it. This was the kind of the statue jail in the back, and you see how we took those gates and we reused them and made them something pretty delicate and to the stairs. But then look at the one statue here, or any of the statues, and they're kind of maybe painted with a roller, I'm guessing. And Father Godfrey had these restored and painted by an artist, and it's the same statue, and just look how, I mean, a world of difference between the two. You know, we also looked for some of the cues there. You know, the baldacchino was existing, and all those beautiful colors were there, and how do you respond to those? And you can see how the blue ceiling works with the gold, the warm tones in the baldacchino. There was a lot of lighting in this baldacchino, and it was easy to see because there was all these wires around there and floodlights and everything. So all that got cleaned up in this process. And then we got done painting the dome, and I think Father Godfrey and I added the sun and the moon. We thought that was the universe needed that. The ceiling, you know, there were three long panels in the ceiling. This one is at the center, right over the crossing, and we thought it was important to put the Benedictine cross there, you know, representing the patron saint of the parish, the priests and monks and seminarians of St. Mildred, the sisters that served the parish over time. And we used at the front, the rule of St. Benedict, one of the rules of St. Benedict in front, and also one back as you enter. This is a good illustration of uplighting in the space, of how we the space seemed to get bigger once we changed colors behind this arcade. You know, it was all kind of blended in before. Everything was a little bit of one color besides the orange that was in there. But what we did was responded to the hierarchy of the architecture. Father said it has great bones, it just wasn't organized and expressed with the painting and the lighting and everything else in the space. A view of the finished product. So we tried to create harmony there. I'm going to turn things back over to Father.
Thank you, Michael. I had comments. Yeah. I had comments throughout the whole thing that I kept to myself. That's a miracle. I know that we've been here 45 minutes. As I love to say when I start a retreat talk, I taught seminarians for 14 years, so your bored faces do nothing to me. But I also know that you have a life and you have other things to do. So I'm going to go through the next few slides real quickly and then just finish up with a few quotes. A characteristic of Christians is how they love one another even while they meet the challenge of building a new place for worship. May be difficult, and the fabric of the assembly may fray and even tear. This is from the end of Built of Living Stones. The Spirit's work in the assembly of God's people encourages cooperation so that each can form a task for the building up of the body of Christ. During a building process, the community works together with the diocese, especially when you are a cathedral, and with the universal church as another way of building up the church with the living stones from which God's assembly is made. If community looks upon its work with the eyes of faith, then it can be assured that God will bring the good work to completion. I will tell you that a lot of people walk into the cathedral today and say how beautiful it is. And while I always give credit to Michael, I raised the money, he did the work. I also say if they put $3.4 million into us, we'd look this good too. If you are ever in a parish that needs to renovate or build a church, I would say these words, as we hear so frequently in the scriptures, are important. Do not be afraid. Prudence is not always equal to delay. And sometimes I think that's what parish priests do. Just put it off for whatever poor sap comes after me. But the fruits of the Holy Spirit and the work of a parish, they're beyond what we can calculate. And the emergence of new gifts will astound you if you proceed in faith. And so amazing things happen when we focus on the things that are most important. Hospitality at St. Benedict Cathedral, I can say honestly, is at a totally new level. We have embraced stewardship as a way of life in the last 4 years during a diocesan campaign and the renovation of a church. And over the past 4 years, I am proud of the people of God at St. Benedict Cathedral for making more than 10,000 prayer commitments over these 4 years, 6,750 ministry commitments, and an offertory increase each year of $175,000. It pays for the ministry of the church. We have more than 40 ministries going in our parish, and I think a lot of the new life that we have encountered has everything to do with the renovation of our church and the hope that we saw. General instruction of the Roman Missal, pardon me, I am an old liturgy teacher, says in the section on the choice of the Mass and its parts, in planning the celebration, then, the priest should consider the common spiritual good of the people of God rather than be concerned about his own inclinations. He should also remember that choices are to be made in consultation with those who have any role in the celebration, including the faithful, in regard to the parts that more directly belong to them. If it is true about the choice of Mass texts, it is absolutely true about renovating the church. Not simply the priest's own inclinations, but the common spiritual good of the people of God. In the prayer that ends the bulleted diction of the extraordinary Jubilee of Mercy that Pope Francis established a few years ago, he started that prayer with these words, O God, who reveal your power above all in your mercy. And then the prayer goes on. But I believe that when a person walks into the church, they should notice in the design and the decoration the mercy of God. They should encounter that mercy very simply as they enter the place where they are. Last year in our convocation for the priests of Evansville, Father James Sullivan, a Dominican priest, said, never forget, fathers, that when you are preaching, the people are suffering. Now, he didn't mean that the way that it sounds, although let's face it, we've all been there. But I think what he's trying to help us understand is the need for mercy, and that mercy needs to be conveyed, of course, in the decoration of the church. Acts 2, 6 through 11. At this sound, they gathered in a large crowd, but they were confused because each one heard them speaking in his own language. They were astounded and in amazement. They asked, are not all these people who are speaking Galileans? And how does each of us hear them in his own native language? We are Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, inhabitants of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the districts of Libya near Cyrene, as well as travelers from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. Yet we hear them speaking in our own tongues of the mighty acts of God. I remember when we renovated the Abbey Church, Father Harry, who was in charge of that renovation, said numerous times, our goal is to create a church where everyone will appreciate at least one thing in it. And I think that was noble for a monastic space, certainly, where everyone is an expert in the liturgy. However, in a parish church, it seems to me, what we must realize is that the design and the use of that space should draw people in the same way that the beauty of the Spirit's presence drew people in on that first Pentecost. And so there should be a welcoming of people whose preferences differ, but whose preferences should all lead to life eternal in Jesus Christ the Lord. Now we'll take just a few minutes for questions and answers, maybe about five. We're still under an act. Anybody have a question? Yes.
Do you have people in the parish that gave like their own skills and talents?
We had some of that. The wooden floors were redone by a parishioner. We steered clear of that in certain more professional issues because the statues had been painted by a parishioner before. Maybe paint by number, but anyway. Yes. Entheos.
Well, we designed the piece. We didn't execute it. So we would find craftspeople to execute those things. Am I answering your question?
Yeah.
We're a small staff of about seven architects, and probably half, four of those people work on the project pretty consistently.
Yes. Got it. So how did we basically renovate when people had given to the building of the church before? The windows would have been a disaster. If we started messing with the windows, I would have been killed. Because there are names in every window. Every single window in the church has names. The rest of it, I think even the lady that did the statues knew they didn't work out so well. And so there were certain things, like people said, what's wrong with that tabernacle that looks like a tent? Well, there were beautiful moments in the renovation that you could never make up. So the tabernacle that's currently in the cathedral belonged to the Port Clare nuns, and they desperately wanted the parish to be built next door to their monastery. So much so that they allowed the parish to meet in their public side of their chapel for the first year that it was in existence. That's their tabernacle. That was the tabernacle that the parishioners first saw when the parish was founded. I told that story a couple of times, and somebody came up and said, Father, I'll pay for the refurbishing of the tabernacle. And I'm like, good, okay. But I think part of it was very much like Michael said, instead of going in after fights, the idea was to help people see what it could be. The beauty of it was the parish has been in debt basically the entire time that it's been in existence, with a few exceptions in the 50s and 60s. But that was taken care of when the bishop stole all the parish's money and built the Catholic high school with it, which they still are angry about. But I think that debt made every change to the church on a not even on a budget, but just with whatever. So you saw the simplicity, that's a very nice word, the simplicity of the ambo, that was actually the third communion rail that had been refashioned into an ambo that had a plywood top. So that's what we were mostly dealing with, so it wasn't difficult. Everybody was glad to get rid of the plywood. Yes, Father Harry. One thing that you will like, one thing that you will hate. I can honestly say I haven't hated anything.
I was going to ask Mr. Eagan, when you go to a parish to begin a project, what are you looking for in the pastor?
Would you like me to leave?
probably guidance and vision, you know, a willingness to, I don't know, take a chance, you know, because it's not easy, you know, all the things that you mentioned about, you know, of, you know, who came before us and how you negotiate that, it's a challenge. And the pastors that don't have opinions, it really, you struggle, because a lot of people defer to the pastor, and you need, it's kind of a nice gauge of where we are, you know, so those things.
I never told him no to anything that he suggested, except these arches right here, the first rendition of those were red. Remember that designer lady that fell on the floor during the meeting? She wanted those to be red. And I said, those will not be red. And that was the only thing I said no to.
Yeah. So the way we work is, you need to hear the whole story. you know, we give them options. We don't walk in like the magic drawing. We have A, B, and C, and you tell us what works in each of these or what doesn't work, and we find our way to the one that works. And so one was a warm palette, one was a cool palette, one was a little more bold than the other, whatever, apparently. Red.
You don't even remember. I will tell you that choosing an architect that understands the documents and teaching of the church makes all the difference in the world. And we saw that in the renovation of the cathedral. He knows what he's talking about. And so, I don't know, were we the first church that you guys worked on in Evansville? In the diocese of Evansville?
No.
Four branch. Yeah, so, but now four? Yeah.
Yes.
So they're also doing the work on St. Joseph Parish in Jasper. Pray for him. It's been our pleasure to be here. Michael says, I don't do talks like this, and you do talks all over. But I wanted us to be able to work together, because I don't think it's been common for a pastor and an architect to do this presentation. And I hope that the two perspectives have been helpful to you. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you so much, Father Godfrey and Mr. Eagan. I'd like to invite everyone to the alumni commons for a social, and Father Godfrey and Mr. Eagan will be there. And so if you have any follow-up questions, I'm sure you'd be happy to engage you. So thank you for coming, and thanks again to Father Godfrey and Mr. Eagan.